I want us to prepare ourselves for the rest of the week. Can we do that? Amen. I want to share with you this visitation that God gave me. I've had two visitations from him in the last month. Two. About six weeks. And the Lord has shook me. He has shaken me to the very core. I know why we exist as a ministry. What God has done, it takes a spiritual mind and heart to believe it. But then again, what if some don't believe? Does that make the faith of God of none effect? What God has purposed to do, he will do. He will do. And I want you to be even as I was, as I am, after listening to the Lord. So tonight we're going to prepare ourselves. I want you to go to chapter 1 in your study guides. And if you don't have a study guide, if you've never ever acquired a study guide before, you need to get this one. You need to get this one. Glory to God. You need to get this one. You need to study this every day, every night, every day, every night. Until it get in your spirit. When we leave out of here, when we leave here Sunday, if you open your hearts to hear God, you will never be the same. Never. Never, ever. Your walk in God will change forever. You'll see God. I can promise you that. And you'll see yourself. God has opened my eyes. Glory to God. Let me just read the vision that God gave me. Mary Banks, a servant of Jesus Christ, to those who are sanctified by God and preserved in Jesus, and called to be his witnesses. Mercy, peace, and love be multiplied unto you. I'm writing to you of the common salvation because it is needful that I do so. This whole week is about salvation. From right now to Sunday morning, we're going to talk about salvation. And when we're done, you're going to know what salvation really is. And I can say this, I have never in all of the years that I've been in the world, I have never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ preached. The entire gospel. Never. God has given me and some others revelation over the years, gave us some awesome truths. And you know what he said to me, Mike? He said, I gave you truths and you ran with them. He said, and they brought you to a place where you preferred holiness. That's what they were supposed to do. He said, and you ran. He said, what you didn't understand. My prayer was this. My prayer was, Lord, why? 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 When people listen to me preach, this is a conversation the Lord and I had. I said, when people listen to me preach, one thing they all say is that Dr. Banks can really teach, and she can break the word down to where they can understand it. I said, but if they do, why is it so hard to believe? Why do some find it so difficult to believe what is being taught? And the Lord said to me, they have not understood, and neither have you. I said, oh. I mean, what you gonna say when God tell you you don't understand? He said, you took the truth I gave you. You embraced it. You ran, and you preferred me. You gave up the world, and you clung to me, but you still have not understood. Hallelujah. And I believe that when we understand, we'll never be the same. Never. Look at your neighbor and say, God is faithful. I also exhort you to earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. I heard Apostle Mike say one of his messages a long time ago. He said, the devil has called us out. I think that's what he said. He said, there's a call out. Satan is not intimidated by the church. In fact, the church is being intimidated by him. Satan has merged. I heard Apostle Mike say there's been a merger. Hallelujah. Glory to God. But somebody got to contend. Somebody got to stand up. Glory to God, and be what God has created. Somebody got to not compromise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We got to contend for the faith, for there are certain doctrines that have crept into the body of Christ that turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. Now, see, that's the tactic of the enemy now. See, that's the tactic. I remember the old school. See, everything about tradition wasn't bad. They taught us to fear God. They taught us holiness is the way. Mm-hmm. They told us to run and don't look back. Hallelujah. But the devil saw that he was losing ground with the prosperity message. So he brought in some more doctrines that favored, kind of had a resemblance of holiness, a similitude of righteousness, but they don't yield holiness. He made our salvation palatable so that people wouldn't feel, you know, someone left BT, they left Bible teachers, they said because the word here is too condemning. Well, the only way I feel condemned is when I'm in sin. You can't make me feel condemned if I'm holy. Come on, somebody. If you preaching holiness and I'm holy, there's no condemnation for those who walk after the Spirit and not after the flesh. So if you feel condemned, you need to find your way to the altar. And you ought to be glad that I'm preaching. Glory to God. I better be glad that I'm reaching your soul. Hallelujah. And don't try to override that condemnation. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Yes, say, yes. Holy God. Holy God. Holy God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. He says here, glory to God. I will therefore put you in remembrance, though you once knew this. Glory to God. This preacher was preaching. Jude was preaching. He said, you knew this. How that the Lord, listen to this. Now, this is an old common salvation message that the apostle Jude preached. He says, now, you knew this. How that the Lord, having saved the people out of Egypt, had already got them out. Come on, somebody. Some of us done been saved. But he's trying to show us the character of our God. He said, after he saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterwards destroyed them that believed not. Hallelujah. See, we're not going to change God. We're not going to change God. God wants to change us. Come on, somebody. He wants us to change our mind. Now, why would this preacher remind us? He said, I'm going to put you in remembrance of something. Since you're about to lose your mind, falling behind all this foolishness, let me remind you of something. You know what he's basically saying? He's saying the same God that was back there that brought him out of Egypt is the same God that brought you out of the world. Come on, somebody. And just like those, when he brought them out of Egypt that didn't believe, he destroyed them. Guess what? Those of us that he brought out of the world, if we don't believe, we're headed for destruction. Are you hearing God? He said, I just want to put you in remembrance of something. Glory to God. Because see, somebody telling you, glory to God, that you can't lose your salvation. But this Bible just said that after he had saved them. See, Jude preaching to the church. He's not preaching to Israel. He preaching to the church. He said, after they were saved, he destroyed them. Now, if that doesn't apply to us, why is it in the New Testament? What significance does it have? Why would he write that to us, Helen, if it doesn't have anything to do with us? It's just what it says. He's putting us in remembrance. You know what he's saying? You need to sober up. Don't you let anybody spoil you with vain philosophy. Let me remind you of the God that you serve. It's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of a living God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. A God that doesn't have to compromise. A God that is a jealous God. I remember when the heathens took the Ark of the Covenant, put it in their temple, in front of Dagon, their God. Glory to God. And every morning they got up, Dagon and fell down at the foot of the Ark. Hallelujah. Bow down to God. Hallelujah. They prop him back up again. The next day they come in, he's down again on his face. Done bowed before God. Let me tell you, before it's over, every knee gonna bow. And every tongue gonna confess. that Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah. And if Jesus said, I'm the only way to God, guess what? He's the only way to God. I don't care who else say you can get there any other way. Glory to God, he's a thief and a robber. He's a liar. He's trying to steal your soul from you. Glory to God, let the devil know you's a lying wonder. Glory to God, there's only one way to God, and his name is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Are you hearing God? Come on, we gonna get sober here. We gonna sober up. Glory to God. So we're not shaking and wheeling and rocking and glory to God, moved out of place by every wind that blowing. Glory to God, we gonna stand still and be steadfast, immovable, so that we can abound in the things of the Lord. Come on and shout glory, somebody. Glory to God, glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And the angels, he said, now not only did he kill, hallelujah. You got a microphone there, man? Hallelujah. Not only did he kill, destroyed the children of Israel that he brought out of Egypt, but he said, and the angels, now why this preacher preaching to the church? He said, and the angels, which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he has reserved in everlasting chains under the darkness until the judgment of the great day. Even the angels. You know God always called angels holy. His holy angels. But those that left, those that looked on the earth at the daughters of men, and decided that they would come down as men. Hallelujah. And take these women as wives, left their own habitation, walked the earth like they were men. Mm-hmm. God said, I took them off the earth. Good God Almighty. I created them, but I took them off the earth. I took them off, and glory to God, I put them in the pit, chained them up. They chained right now, reserved. And guess what they waiting on? They waiting on the saints of God to judge them. They waiting on the real church to judge them. The Bible say, don't you know you're going to judge angels? Hallelujah. Are you hearing God? Are y'all hearing God? Do you know how many millions, if not even billions, of angels there are? You can't even imagine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Listen to what it say. Glory to God. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh, are set forth for and what? To who? An example for who? Sodom and Gomorrah? Now he lists a couple of things here. Fornication. Going after strange flesh. Huh? So it sounds like he's saying that if we do the same thing, we'll be just like them. Come on. Didn't that say example, Pastor? So Sodom and Gomorrah is an example. And the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication, strange flesh, set forth an example, suffering the vengeance of what? Somebody say that God would not put his people in hell forever. But put his people in a lake of fire forever. This says eternal fire. The story of the rich man and Lazarus wasn't no parable. He didn't say that was a parable. That was literal. Hallelujah. Are y'all hearing God? Why would you tell us about eternal fire? Why? If why? He's talking to the church. can't lose out with God. Hallelujah. Oh, yeah, we can lose out. Hallelujah. And he's going to convince you before it's over. It was Friday night, June 27th, around midnight, when I got up from the computer to get a little rest before continuing to write the study guide for World Conference 2014. As I lay across the bed, my spirit was stirred within me. Suddenly, I was carried away in the spirit into a great house. It was a very nice house with lovely furniture and accessories. There were two people in the house, a middle-aged woman who was busy setting a huge table as if preparing for guests, and an elderly man who seemed to be related to the woman. I stood in the entrance that separated the dining room from the kitchen. The old man walked past me, went to the door, opened it, and picked up something. It was a baby that appeared to be only a few days old. The baby had been outside and was cold and nearly frozen to death. The old man took the baby over to the stove, turned the oven on low heat, and placed the baby in the oven. In amazement, I yelled at the man. Saints, I saw this so plain, just like I'm looking at you now, I saw it. Glory to God. God carried me away in the spirit. And I was in this house. And these are the things I saw. I yelled at the man, "Why are you putting that baby in the oven?" The man turned around and looked at me. "No, the baby is not dead, but she will die in that oven." The man turned and looked at me. Though he was old in years, he was not frail. Hallelujah. You want to read this for me?
"And I sensed that he had a little strength in him."
He had some strength. He was an old man, but he wasn't, you know, a weakling.
Amen.
You could tell if he needed to fight, he could fight.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
"Finally," he said, "don't worry about the baby. She will be fine."
That's what he said. He looked at me like, "Don't worry." You know?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
"I turned to the woman who had been in the kitchen all the while busying herself with preparations. She was also constantly going back and forth to the mirror to look at herself, making sure everything about her was together."
Now this lady, she was setting the table. But while she was setting the table, she would go to the mirror and she would look at herself in the mirror. And then she'd go back and do something else in the kitchen, and then she'd run back to the mirror. And she'd look, and she couldn't walk past a mirror without looking at herself.
Mm.
And she's just looking at herself.
My Lord.
And then, glory to God, she'd do some more, and then she'd go back to the mirror. She could not pass the mirror. She had to keep looking at herself and making sure everything was just right.
"My God. I said to the woman, 'Why is he doing this? The baby will die in that oven.'
Mm-hmm.
She never even looked up at me, but said, 'Don't worry yourself. That baby will be just fine.'"
She was so indifferent. She was indifferent. It was like I was the only one upset.
My Lord.
I was the only one upset, but here this baby is in the oven. And she didn't even look up. She said, "Don't worry yourself about that baby." And you could tell that she and the old man were on one accord. She knew what he was doing. She knew he put the baby in the oven. She knew. But she didn't, it didn't faze her. Not one bit. Mm-hmm.
"At this point, I walked over to the stove. The oven oven had a glass window in the door of it, mm-hmm. and I could clearly see the baby lying on the rack, but she didn't appear to be in any pain.
You know how a baby just, you know, just laying there? And the baby, you could see the little feet sticking up and the little hands, and the baby was looking. He looked over at me, and I was looking at the baby. The baby just, see, the baby was almost dead. It was frozen. But now the baby was thawed out. It was thawing out. And the baby could move its hands and its feet. But the baby didn't know it was in an oven. Read.
She was almost completely thawed out and was just lying there smiling at me. I couldn't move. I stood there watching the baby. The man and the woman continued whatever they were doing and acted as if I wasn't there. I thought to myself, this child doesn't realize that the oven is going to get hotter and will surely die in there.
Uh-huh.
I frantically began to plead with the man and the woman to take the baby out of the oven.
Uh-huh.
It's getting too hot and the baby is going to die. They totally ignored me, so I rushed back over to the stove.
Uh-huh.
The baby was looking at me, but this time she wasn't smiling.
Uh-huh.
I looked in her eyes, and I saw that she was not only in pain, but confused and scared.
Uh-huh.
The oven had gotten very hot, and the baby was beginning to burn.
Hallelujah. Saints, I will never, as long as I live, forget the look on that baby face. That baby was lying there like this, and she was looking at me. And you know how those ovens made with the big glass in the front where you can see what's going on in the oven? She was lying up against the glass, like the rack that she was on. She had kind of leaned over, and her face was up against the glass, and she was looking at me, and she stared right at me, but this time she wasn't smiling. That oven had gotten so hot, and the rack that she was on was you know how to make those lines across the back? And I was standing there in horror. Because I'm like, and I'm stuck. You know, I'm frozen. And I'm looking at this baby, and this baby didn't move, just looking right at me. And it was looking at me like it was pleading. Do something. Do something. But of course the baby couldn't talk. But it had a pleading look on its face. Read, Pastor.
Instinctively, I opened the oven and took the baby out.
Mm-hmm.
I picked up a white cloth and placed the baby in the cloth. As I held the baby in my hands and said to the man and the woman, "See, the baby is burned." The woman went on about her business, setting her table. But the old man said, "I'll put the baby back in the oven." I said, "But the baby is already burned. Look at her." At that point, I looked at the baby, who was also looking directly at me. There was a look of pleading in her eyes. But then the man said, "I'll put the baby back in the oven and just turn the temperature down a bit." The woman agreed, but suddenly the baby shouted, "No, you can't do that."
Glory to God. Saints, I was holding the baby like this. This baby couldn't have been no more than a week old. And when that man said the second time that he was going to put the baby back in the oven, the baby shouted with a loud shout that filled that whole house. "No! You can't do that!" And I knew I had to hold that baby. Because I knew if I let go of that baby, they were going to put it back in the oven. And I was holding on to that baby. And the baby was looking at me like, "Don't let him do it." Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Read, Pastor.
Then she looked up at me as if to say, "Please don't let them do that." Somehow the baby understood that she would die in the oven, but she wanted to live. I knew I had to hold on to her and protect her from the old man and the woman. When I came to myself, I was shaken to the core. I said, Lord, what is the meaning of this vision? In my spirit, I heard. The baby is my church.
The baby is my church.
My Lord.
Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm.
Saints, our God is ready to visit his church.
Yes, God.
He is coming to visit his church. He said, the baby is my church. Read.
This too is a brand that is plucked out of the fire.
My God, he said they were taken. My church has already escaped the fire. Those that are born again, they've escaped hell.
Mm-hmm.
But somebody is taking them back to the fire.
My Lord Jesus.
This is my house. Glory to God.
My God.
Jesus. Read, Pastor.
For many years, my people have wandered in the wilderness of sin and found themselves to be wretched and bewildered with the very little life left in them. Mm-hmm. The house you saw is my kingdom.
The house was decorated.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just beautiful furniture.
Mm-hmm.
Matching all kinds of accessories, the best of silverware. It was just a beautiful home. God said, that's my kingdom.
It is thoroughly furnished with all that is needed to nurture my people.
Everything that it takes for God's people to make it to the millennium, God has given.
My God.
He said he took us out of the fire.
Mm-hmm.
And now there are those that are taking us back to the fire.
My God.
Hallelujah. In the house, but in the oven.
Mm-hmm.
They are placed the people of God in damnation.
My Lord.
In the house. The baby was put in the oven by those who were in the house. Hallelujah.
My God.
That's why he said we got to contend for the faith.
That's right.
We got to fight for the souls of God's people. That's what preachers do.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. Read, Apostle.
The old man is tradition.
Mm-hmm.
The way of men.
Mm-hmm.
And the woman is the doctrine of devils.
Hallelujah.
The table she sets is for her prophets.
My Jesus.
These care nothing for my church.
Let me tell you something. See, I wait on God. Because when God says something, he backs himself up. He backs himself up, Mark. Nothing God says ever come back void. He said that woman is doctrines of devils.
Mm.
And that old man is tradition. The ways of men. The ways of men. Their mentality. Their ideology. They have perverted theology. And they've taken and they've come up with their own rendition of God. And it's taking the people of God into damnation. Read, Apostle.
These care nothing for my church.
They don't care anything about.
I have called you to speak the truth that will heal my people. It will be as a healing balm on their wounds.
Saints, He's going to tell us what he did. He's going to tell us in a way that we never heard before. And we're going to know how great a salvation this is. We're going to know that there's nothing compared to us. There's nothing in this world to compare to us. Hallelujah. I want us to be prepared to hear what God got to say this week. Apostle Mike.
Come on, God deserves better than that. Hallelujah. I want to ask you a question that you can probably only answer in your own conscience. How many believe you heard from God already? Amen. This is so important that you believe that you're already hearing from God. See, this has to go past your mentality. This has to go past your bachelor's degree in theory. Amen. It has to go past all of that and go straight to your spirit. How many, when you heard the vision, it attached itself to something in your soul called the Holy Ghost? Come on, somebody. That it just bear witness. See, all cannot bear witness with the truth, because all don't hold the spirit of truth. But some of us that hold the spirit of truth, it already bear witness that this is the truth. Oh, hallelujah. Is anybody hearing this word? It already bear witness. I'm not at a place where Dr. Banks, I have to take the burden off of Dr. Banks. And I have to take the burden off even myself as a minister. But I'm not at the point where Dr. Banks has to convince me that she's heard from God. Because when she communicated it, the same God, amen, is in me. Come on, somebody. And the same God is testifying that that's the truth. Oh, is anybody hearing God? How many of you, amen, when you was listening, God took you right into that house. God showed you that old man, and God showed you that woman going back and forth. Oh, is anybody hearing God? See, some of us was not just, amen, in church to say we came to church. But some of us are in the spirit. Yeah. Oh, is anybody hearing God? And the Bible says, they that are of the spirit do mind the things of the spirit. Hallelujah. Yes, I feel compassion, but which may be the same thing, but I feel sorrow for those that could be sitting in the midst of God but can't hear him. My Lord Jesus. Yes. Yes. For whatever the blockage may be, but can't hear God. You know, that's something that I've always feared. I've always feared being in the presence of God, but can't discern him. Can't feel him. He's talking. He's pleading to my heart and my conscience, but there's a blockage that I can't allow him to penetrate. Amen. But when she began to minister tonight, I was in the house. I was in the house, and I'm saying, Mom, when are you going to get the baby? You see, the man don't care. You see, the old lady don't care. You have to do what we do. See, Doc, what we do, we'll ask you about one or two times. And if you act like you really don't want to do it, guess what? We're going to go learn how to do it ourselves. And when you look around, the baby in our arms. Hallelujah. How many of you was like me, you waiting to that part where she say, I just took the baby out the oven? Come on, somebody. Because we was agonizing with that baby. Oh, hallelujah. It's not a laughing matter. We was agonizing with that baby. And that's the burden we should feel for the church. We shouldn't stand in judgment of the church and in ridicule of the church, but we should try to rescue the church. Oh, is anybody hearing God? We can't spend our time condemning the baby. The baby in the oven now. Oh, anybody hearing God? Hallelujah. Amen. The baby in the oven. The baby needs assistance. Hallelujah. You can preach to it once you get it out the oven. You can clean it up once you get it out the oven. But we need to do our due diligence and get the baby out the oven. Come on, somebody. And I hear the devil. Amen. So I'm going to address you right quick. Amen. Yes, we believe that we are the ministry called to get the baby out the oven, because that's what God said. Yes, we believe that. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody, stand with me. If you believe you was called to get the baby out the oven, don't let the devil intimidate you and say that that's arrogance. That's not arrogance. That's what God said. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. We were called to get the baby out the oven. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. The devil will tell you, well, you know, you don't need to say that. That sounds like you're separating yourself. But if God said that we were called to get the baby out the oven, then that's what we were called to do. And I don't know if we're the only ones, but what if we are? There was only one Moses. There was only one David. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. What if we are? We're not boasting in ourselves. We're boasting in our Lord. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Don't let the devil bind you, tell you what to agree to. Amen. You agree with God. We've come through many rough plains. We've come over mountaintops and hilltops and low valleys. But God preserved us, Auntie Kathy. But for what? Not to blend in, but to stand out. Anybody hearing God? To be a difference, to be a standard. Somebody. Sister Sherry, you was called to do more than just sing. You was called to get the baby out the oven. Pastor Helen, you was called to do more than just sing. You was called to get the baby out the oven. Sister Julie, you was called to do more than just sing. You was called to get the baby out the oven. Come on, somebody. Hear the devil saying, but some of you are liars, and some of you are backsliders, and some of you are homosexuals, and some of you are fornicators. And I could tell the devil, you're right, but the key word is word. Come on, somebody. But he that's the Son has set free is free indeed. Anybody hearing God? If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Come on. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. God Almighty. I say, good God Almighty. I feel like Jesus when a whole bunch of people was around him. Hallelujah. And they say, your mother is looking for you. And he says, who is my mother? Who is my brother? Come on, somebody. For I must be about my Father's business. Somebody got to get the baby out the oven and stop just clapping. Stop just saying amen. But somebody got to get their hands in the oven. Come on, somebody. I don't know why he called us. We was not the best people. I don't even know what was his plan. But oh, I'm so glad he did call me. If you're glad that he called you, you ought to at least put your hands together. If you're glad that he called your name, you ought to at least just shout glory. Glory. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My soul does love him. Hallelujah. Jesus. Jesus. I say because I know that there's hope in Jesus. The baby don't have to burn up and die. The church is not going to wither and die. Come on, somebody. Because Jesus is married to the church. He won't leave it in the oven. Come on, somebody. The devil think he has a victory, but there is no victory. Come on, somebody. I need y'all to just sit on down for a minute. Because you're pumping me. Hallelujah. But when our apostle was ministering, and Mom, we just applaud you tonight. We're so glad you're in Leesburg, Florida. Hallelujah. Amen. I want to say something, and that is, I know some of us are overachievers. You know, we get the study guide and we just read on through it. You know, try to get an ideal on what the word going to be. Baby, you're going to read that study guide, but it's going to take an apostle to break that study guide down to you. You need to be there every session. You need to come. This is not a book report. This is not an essay you write. You need an apostle to take them words off the page and make them alive in your consciousness. Come on, somebody. That's why God say, don't forsake the assembling together of yourselves. We need to come together and sit at the Lord's feet. Oh, is anybody hearing God? Amen. But I was thinking on that part that you said about, amen, the man being tradition, the ways of men. Oh, my Lord. And the woman being the doctrines of devils. I say, wow. Doctrines of devils. Yes. And I begin, and the Lord, when you were talking, the Lord identified something to me. You know? I don't know. I got on all this black tonight. So I may not look like a child of light with all this black on. But it's actually light up under this black. It's light up under this brown. Come on, somebody. Amen. And it's actually an apostle in here somewhere. He in here somewhere. Come on, somebody. But I cited my apostleship to lay a foundation. Lately, see, I don't listen to, like, the radio often. Some people listen to the radio. I don't really listen to the radio often because we have one gospel station here and it plays one kind of gospel music, you know, that I just get tired of after a while. And I'm like, I can't hear that guitar no more. All that's starting to sound alike. You know, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Z. Amen. Hallelujah. But you want me to change mics? Give it up for my MIA, Pastor Jarrell. That's my little big bro. But I kind of consolidated my radio listening, you know, because of that. And you know you ain't finna listen to the crazy stuff, you know. So, but I found a station where they preach. They preach, you know, and they preach all day, basically. They preach all day. And I have been listening to them. When I get in the car, they just preaching. And they be preaching some good stuff. But recently I heard them preaching. And Mom, you may need to help me with the terminology of this. But they were preaching on, you're not saved by your works. You ever heard that doctrine? You're not saved by works, but you're saved by grace. That's a very popular, the grace doctrine. And recently, oh my God, it broke my heart. Sunday morning, one of my champion teachers, who I listen to all the time, he started preaching it. And I'm like, wow. And we were getting ready for church. I said, baby, that part right there, we can't agree with that. When he was like, there's nothing you could do to earn salvation because you were saved by grace, you know. And I understood where he was coming from by you cannot earn salvation. Amen? I understood that. But is it a work to live holy when you were created holy? I'm not trying to be a man. I'm a man. So the same should be true about being a son of God. I'm not working out to be a son of God. I'm just a son of God. Are you all working with me? Amen. That's my reasonable service, you know, to present my body holy and acceptable and a living sacrifice unto God, right? So is it a work? Why do we make holiness a work? You know, why do we make holiness a work? Pastor Dexter, can you help me? I need your help, Pastor Dexter. If you would just take a stance over there. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Pastor Theo, can you help me? Amen. Hallelujah. I'm going to be the only one up here with some hair. Hallelujah. Don't I look unique? Come on, Pastor Jackson. But I want to show something. I was in between two doctrines. One doctrine that says that by grace you're saved, which is true. That statement is true. But it is also saying that there is no consequence for not living holy. That is untrue. Are you all working with me? Hallelujah. Are you all working with me? And then I'm over here with another whole nother doctrine that nobody's really going to hell. Nobody really going to hell. You know? Are you all working with me? Come here, Pastor Byron, if you would just go on the stage for me right quickly. Amen. Hallelujah. Then I got another doctrine telling me to go dig up every dream I ever had before Jesus. Now Jesus is going to help me fulfill all these dreams. Or is anybody hearing God? Hallelujah. Then I got another doctrine. Come on, Brother Mark. Amen. That's saying God is doing a new thing. God is doing a new thing, and there's a new word. It's dangerous to say that there's a new word, because the Bible don't speak of a new word. Come on, somebody. Amen. So look at this oven that I'm incubating in. Anybody hearing God? All this stuff that I want to hear. But when you first came to the glass, I was in oblivion. I was oblivious to my real state. And that's where the church is. The church want to believe that they're not going to go to hell because they were saved by so much grace that covered all of his sin. They want to believe that. Matter of fact, nobody's going to hell. The church want to believe that God want to give them everything the world already has. The church want to believe that there's a new doctrine that don't include hell. And the church is in the oven. And those that bring the truth now will be the minority. Oh, is anybody hearing God? Prophetess, you hear? If we bring the truth, prophetess, we become the minority. Oh, is anybody hearing God? Hallelujah. Believe it or not, some going to fight to stay in the oven. Because they're dealing in the comfort part of it. They don't see the severity of where they are. And so you appear to be an enemy to them when you say all of this stuff that has impacted your thinking, impacted your mind, in believing that God is a promiscuous God, in believing that God is not as holy as he is righteous. All this stuff is a trap. And it's getting harder and harder and harder. But yea, I say unto thee, is some people going to hear the voice of the Lord, and they're going to flee from all these sensual doctrines. They're going to flee from all of this and say, even if though it's what I wanted to hear, I know it's not the truth. Oh, is anybody hearing this word? Is anybody hearing this? And hallelujah, God. And I was looking, Doc. This is the reason why I cited my apostleship, because I don't hardly bring that up that much. Amen. It don't matter how much you talk about it. You just got to be it. Come on, somebody. Amen. I don't hardly bring that up. Amen. Hallelujah. But the reason why I cited my apostleship is because I saw how the enemy was trying to subliminally change my mind. Because if he changed my mind, he know that I could preach you into the same change. Y'all quiet. It's been men and women of God that have deceived the church. But it started with their own deception. It started when they gave way to the doctrine of devils. Is anybody hearing God? That's why I thank God for being connected to a true apostle. I thank God for being connected to a true prophet, a true prophetess, to a true evangelist, the true body of Christ. Because that connection, like Lisa says, that connection keeps a foundation in us that we can't go very far. We are the people that the world was talking about when it says raise up a child in the way that they ought to go and they won't stray far from it. Come on, somebody. So when I was hearing these things, even from men that I really revere and respect, I say that's a doctrine of devils. I don't care how eloquently it is put, it's still the devil. See, that woman was making sure she was pretty. Because you got to make a lie presentable. Oh, anybody hearing God? You got to make it presentable. You got to dress it up. Come on, somebody. Sometimes the truth's so ugly. Come on, somebody. The truth just come in with flip-flops, cut-off shorts. Come on, somebody. Ain't combed this hair because it knows that the core of it is what you need. It's not all that stuff on the outside. It's the core of it that's going to bring you life. But the lie will be dressed up so pretty, and it'll stay in the mirror making sure it's pretty. That when it get in your face, you think you're looking at Jesus. You ain't looking at Jesus. It ain't Jesus telling you that hell done closed up and is not receiving anybody else. It ain't Jesus telling you that you were saved by so much grace that God don't see your sin.
Jesus ain't never tell you that. What Jesus says, this is the condemnation, that light come into the world, but men love darkness rather than light, because when they come to the light, their deeds are revealed and reproved. Anybody hearing? It was Jesus who said that the way is straight and narrow. It was Jesus that said that I am the only way to God. I am the truth, the way, and the life. It was Jesus that said, many shall stand before God and say, I cast out devils in your name. I healed in your name. And God will say, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity. I know you not. That's what Jesus said.
Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, guys. Let's give God a praise. Come on. That's what Jesus said. Jesus didn't give us, amen, what we wanted to hear. He gave us the truth. He gave us the truth. Now, I want to, amen, oh, Lord, I need the gift of wisdom right now, because I got to tread on some thin ice. Amen, but don't slay me. Amen, hear the conclusion of the matter. Amen, hallelujah. When you walk outside of the boundaries of your faith, you change. You change. But see, in that change, this is where what this is, that thin ice. In that change, you still believe you are discerning God the way you once did when you were in the spirit. But that's not true. Amen? In that walk after the flesh, not blaming the flesh, but when you want to use the flesh to experience life, amen, in a negative way. Oh, is anybody hearing God? You change. Your priority change. Your perspective change. And in that space, you are vulnerable. Your mind is susceptible to the enemy. Come on, somebody. But now, let me see, the devil is wise. The devil wise. And the devil knows what some of our buttons are. He knows what some of our buttons are. And he knows what some of our routines are. Are you all working with me? Amen? He knows. And he knows that we have the Holy Ghost. And he knows with the Holy Ghost comes conviction when we're off course. That's just the truth. Amen? Are you all working with me? He knows that. But one thing about the devil, what the devil would do is try. Well, Doc has already said it. You come out of the fire. You was plucked out of the fire. Did we understand that terminology? In other words, we were in the world on our way to hell. God rescued us. But he didn't just rescue us from the club. But he rescued us from a sinful nature. I want to get to ahead of the study guide, but a nature that embodied the very essence of sin. Our nature was sinful. Come on, somebody. Paul described it this way. He described it as a body of death. But he also said bringing forth fruit unto death. Remember that? In other words, we would be sinning until we die. That's a trap. That's why when we say we're saved, it has a deeper significance than people give credence to. When we say we're delivered, it has a deeper meaning than people even know. Come on, somebody. But God delivered us, Allison, from ourselves, our sinful selves. But now when we came in to the kingdom, sadly to say, the old man was waiting on us. And the woman was waiting on us. They in the house.
That's sad. They in the house. And they don't mean us no well. Are you all working with me? Amen. And what they do is, what doctrines of devils do is, cause you to put on everything you took off. Everything God destroyed by way of salvation, the doctrine of devils rebuild. Oh, if I'm telling the truth, if the Holy Ghost is telling the truth, somebody say amen. Amen. Come on now. Come on now. Let's be real. When you look at the center of the perverted faith and prosperity message, the center of it is lust. That's the center of it, and we know that. You know, a dude that don't go to church will hear that message and know that that's lust. Come on, somebody. And we know that. We're not ignorant of that. But what it is, it's the devil's way of rebuilding everything that God destroyed. But let me go a step further. Where we err as ministers in this ministry, when we preach to the church like the church is not spiritual. When we preach to the church like it is not spiritual, that's a doctrine of the devil. We can't spend our whole ministerial career trying to get people to get along, trying to get people to love each other, trying to get people to forgive. Come on, somebody. We can't move as a church doing that. And the baby gonna die. We can't do that. We have to preach to the church like there are nothing but spiritual beings in here. Come on, somebody. Like there's nobody but spiritual beings in here. So what if somebody say, I didn't get nothing from church tonight? But the spirit man gonna get something. Because I imagine the spirit man have had to sit through years of messages that were not geared toward it. Messages about how this one don't speak to that one. Messages about money. The spirit man don't care nothing about no money. The spirit man don't need money to perform the works of God. Oh, y'all quiet on me. Y'all quiet. Church like it's spiritual. Amen. And back to when we walk after the flesh, and you know, you all know what I mean when I say that. When we walk after the flesh, when we walk in sin, we change, and that will make you vulnerable to the doctrines of devils, the enemy that go to talking to you in that space. And before you know it, you are giving consideration to things you never gave consideration to. You know, you're considering it. Maybe the message is too judgmental. You said a mouthful. Wow, you said a mouthful. I remember, I thank God I ain't there tonight, but I remember you said that same thing one time years ago. I was so mad when you say that. The message seems like it's judgmental when you're in sin. And she just happened to catch me in sin. And she said that, yeah. And you know how mom, yeah. When you don't want to do right and God start preaching on your sin, it seems so judgmental. And then she gonna look at me. I looked at her like I want to get out of this church. But I can't leave the church. My mama the pastor. I can't. People leave church. I can't leave church. Where I'm going to go? If I go to another church, they're going to run me back over here. But that's true. And to be, not in the voice of, or not in the spirit of comedy, when I say that's dangerous. That's a dangerous place to be in, where you reject the word because you're offended with truth. Not because it's not true, but you're just offended with truth. So you just reject it. That's a dangerous place to be in. You just reject truth. Come on, somebody. Because in that rejection, there's no telling how you're going to end up. Come on, somebody. No telling how you're going to end up while you're rejecting the truth. Amen? And so when I hear that word, that maybe we're too judgmental, because the enemy tries to tell me that all the time. That people look at BT and say it's just judgmental. For so many years we've been called those people. Those people. You know? Those people. Y'all too judgmental. Y'all too this, y'all too that. Why are we too judgmental? Let's deal with it. Why are we too judgmental? Because we believe as the scripture has said. So now that makes us too judgmental. Huh? Because we believe that God is so holy, that his holiness is so far up there that he expects us to meet it only by way of salvation. Amen. Now we're too judgmental because God say, be ye perfect, and we believe that we are. Oh, hallelujah. You notice I didn't say that we can be. I know exactly what I'm saying. I didn't say I say we believe we are. Because when he said, be ye perfect, oh, y'all, he wasn't telling us to come into perfection. He was saying it just like he said, let there be light, and there was light. When he said, be ye perfect, he spoke us into perfection. Y'all ain't with me tonight. We didn't have nothing to do with this perfection. He spoke us into perfection. We don't know why he looked at a piece of dirt and desired to make it perfect. We don't know why he would look at a prostitute and desire to make her perfect. We don't know. But when he said, be ye perfect, we opened our eyes and we were perfect. Oh, y'all quiet. But God deserves better praise than what you're giving him. Come on, somebody. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. They say nobody's perfect. How do you say that? How do you say that? Because man said that? So you mean to tell me, let's just deal with it. You mean to tell me that a perfect God, a perfect, almighty, omnipresent, omnipotent God can come down and get in a being and that being can't be perfect? I don't believe that. I don't believe that a perfect God, a marvelous God, a God that's so miraculous, so marvelous that the only word you can come up with is God when you describe his name. You just got to call him God. You tell me that God can't get in an individual and the individual be perfect? I would understand if we was talking about Satan. I would even understand if we was talking about our earthly parents. But we talking about a perfect God. We talking about an awesome God. Come on, somebody. So stop shortchanging God. Stop saying that he could not do what he said he would do. If God called us perfect, we perfect. Woo! Come on, somebody. Almighty God, he that can make stone into bread, he that can cause his son to walk on water, he that can make a Red Sea open up, he that can tell a lion, close your mouth, he that can make a little boy slay a bear, but he can't make me perfect. Come on, somebody. My God can do it. Come on, somebody. I say, not only can he do it, he has done it. Woo! Come on, somebody. If he can separate the sun from the moon, if he can separate the night from the day, is anybody hearing God? If he can flick the stars in their atmosphere and cause them to remain, he can make me perfect. Woo! Come on, somebody. It was God who told the land, you don't go no further. Now the water begin. It was God who told the bird to fly. It was God who told the fish to swim. He can make me perfect. My God. Oh, Jesus. One day he stood in front of a tomb just to show how strong and mighty he is. He stood in front of a tomb of a man who had been dead for about 4 days, and all he did was call his name, Lazarus, Lazarus, and Lazarus got up. My God can do it. Whoa! Hey! Good God Almighty. And the dead clothes got off the man. Not only did the man get off, but all those mummified clothes had to loose the man. So yes, he has made me perfect. Yes, the body of sin has been destroyed. Yes, the spirit is life because of righteousness. Not because I said so, but because he said so. And if you believe it, you ought to give God praise. Hallelujah. 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 Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm done, Apostle.
Hey! Ay, 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 ay. Come on, church! Hey! Hey, Jesus!
World Conference 2014. And God is speaking to us. And he told me, tell the people to prepare their hearts. Prepare their hearts to hear. I was sitting there when Pastor Mike was preaching. And I was thinking how gravely important this is. It's so important that you need to miss work. You need to put everything on hold. Let's sit before God. When we get in here, glory to God, and start the teaching in the morning, we need to be so alert. I'm going to ask everybody not to eat anything until after the message. Don't eat any breakfast in the morning. Let's fast. Let's don't break the fast in the morning. Let's get up and come to the sanctuary and hear what thus saith the Lord. Let that be our breakfast. I want to read this last part on page 2. It is clearly evident that the church is off course. It has accepted denominationalism, disunion, and discord. We have agreed with the idea of the church being a body having differing views about the same God and the same Christ. Why is this so when the word expressly instructs us to all speak the same thing? The scriptures declare that in these last days, many shall depart from the faith, not bearing sound doctrine and giving heed to seducing spirits and devilish doctrines. Many think in their hearts that it is impossible for the church to be unified and perfected in these last days, but I submit to you that nothing is impossible for God. God will not be defeated by false doctrines or the religious ideologies of men. Paul said he gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive, but speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. It really does not matter if some in the body do not believe that God is able to bring about this unity of the faith. Many believe that the church will always be diversified in beliefs and doctrines, but somehow the Father will gather us all together in the rapture. That is absurd. The Father is the husbandman, and the church is his vineyard. The harvest will be that of good fruit. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. Ephesians 2:10. Let us not scoff at the truth. It has been ordained and predetermined by God that the church will walk in good works, which means that it was ordained to walk in righteousness. And the Father, who cannot lie, is the workman that will bring this perfect, sinless church to the forefront. How? He told us of his plan several years ago. He will exalt truth. It has only been recently that I came to understand the magnitude of that statement. It was only after I was more enlightened as to the mystery of God that I came to know the depths of the lie that has captured the hearts and minds of the people of God. Hallelujah. Before, I thought the Lord would reveal the truth regarding the erroneous prosperity message or the deceptive dual nature syndrome or even the truth about suffering. Therefore, I began to go back over all those lessons and critique them and add increase that had been gathered over the years. I am certain he will pour these truths into the body, and it will change his heart and mind towards God. But the Lord said unto me, these are truths that have brought much contradiction to the lie, but my people continue to struggle to walk in them. It is because they have not comprehended the great mystery of godliness. But I have taught the mystery of godliness many times, I responded. Teach it again, and I will show you even greater depths of this truth. For my spirit has searched out the deep things and will reveal them unto you by my spirit. Speak all my words to the people and show them this great love I have loved them with. For the time has come for them to rise out of their slumbering and sleep. I will speak in the ear that will hear, and the heart that is open will receive this great truth. I have done a marvelous thing, which they know not of, because they have not understood. For the mystery of God is the great salvation of my people. It was at that point the Lord began to show me the real church and all the scriptures we had neglected to understand their true meaning. But it is those scriptures that form the infallible vision that proclaims the rise of the church. But Lord, I'm not worthy to deliver such because I too have failed to sanctify myself to this truth. And the Lord said, open your heart and obey the vision. I want us to go before the Lord. I want us as individuals, because every man got to do this for himself. Every heart got to be prepared to receive what the Lord is going to say to us in the morning. I want everybody. If you want to come to the altar, you can. Break every chain. If you want to come to the altar, you can. If you want to fall down right where you are, you can. If you want to stand on your feet, you can. But I want every voice in here to talk to God. I want you to cry out to him like this may be the last time you get a chance to speak to him. Those of you that are watching online, those of you that are in the locations, Fort Lauderdale, I know you're there, Jamaica, all the locations, Freeport, Bimini, all of the locations that are online tonight. I want you to cry out right where you are. I want us to cry out to God like, glory to God, if you feel like walking around and just talking to him, just walk around and talk to him. If you feel like standing, just stand up and talk to him. If you feel like laying down, lay down and talk to him. Glory to God, whatever's good for you. If you need to come to this altar and bear your soul out to him, come on. But let's don't leave here the same. Because God's going to break every yoke and every chain. Everything. Everything that's standing between me and him. Everything that's standing between us. Everything that keeps us from loving each other. God ready to destroy it tonight. Not tomorrow, but tonight. Tonight. He said, cry out to me. Saints, I want us to lift our voices up before him. Cry out of your belly. Cry out of your belly. You need to cry out to him because the devil's trying to distract you. Talk to him in a loud voice tonight. Don't let the devil be a distraction to you. Come on, lift up your voices. Some of us need to repent. Say, God, have mercy on me. Have mercy. Clean me up, Lord. Clean me up, God. Clean my mind. Clean my heart. Clean my soul. Purify my mind, Lord. Wash my body, God. Sanctify my flesh. Have mercy, God. Have mercy on me. Come on, saints. Let's cry out for mercy tonight. Somebody need to get saved tonight. Somebody need to say, God, save me. I need to be saved. I need to be filled with the Spirit. I want your Spirit, God. I want to know I got it. I want to know I got it. I want to feel it on the inside. God, have mercy. Forgive me for my sins. Wash me. Clean me. Give me your Holy Ghost. Have mercy. Cry out to him. Have mercy. Have mercy. Come on, church. Everybody online, cry out to him.
Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain.
Come out.
Break every chain. Break every chain. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up.
Come on, church. Let's cry out to him. Let's cry out to him. I thank you tonight, Holy God, asking you for mercy tonight, asking you to look down on us, God. Have mercy on us tonight, Jesus. Watch us, God. Watch us, Father. We've sinned against you, Lord. We've done our own ways, God. Have mercy, God. Sanctify us in our inner man. Sanctify us, Lord. Sanctify our spirits tonight. Sanctify our minds tonight. God, have mercy. Have mercy on us. Have mercy. We stood up in our pride. We stood up in unmercifulness, unforgiveness, in iniquities. Father, have mercy. We sought after this world. But God, have mercy. We ask for mercy tonight. We ask you to forgive us, Lord. Cleanse us. Wash us. Set us free from captivity. Lord, where we willingly, we've been willing captives. We yielded our members to unrighteousness. Lord, have mercy. Have mercy on us. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us, Lord. We're guilty. We're guilty before you. We're guilty. But oh God, you're a merciful God. Remember your mercy tonight. Remember your mercy, God. We're your people. Called by your name. You done brought us this far. Have mercy, Lord. Have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy, Lord. Wash us. 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 Have mercy. Have mercy on us. Clean us up. Glory to your name. Sanctify us. Sanctify us to your truth. Sanctify us, Lord. Take away blood guiltiness tonight. Take it away. Let the blood purge us. Yes, Jesus. 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 My soul say yes to you. My soul say yes. My soul say yes. My soul say yes. 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 Yes, Lord. Yes to your will. Yes. Yes. Yes to your way. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Want to be holy. We just want to be holy. Have your way. Take us, Lord. Take over these vessels. We just want to be holy. We want to be righteous. We're willing to obey you, Lord. We submit to you, Lord. We submit to you. We submit to you. Jesus. 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 We submit, Jesus. We submit to you. We got. Where do we go if not with you? We turn away from the world and we reach out for you, Lord. We reach out for you. Our hearts reach out for you. We turn away from this world. We're committing our life to you. One more time. From the depths of our soul, we say yes to you. We say yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus.
From the bottom of my heart,
yeah, Lord,
to the depths of my soul, it's yes, Lord. Oh, Lord, completely yes. My soul says yes. Oh, the Bible.
You've been blessed. Have you really been blessed? Amen. Amen. I want to thank God. I want everyone from the States to join in with me to thank God for all of our Jamaican delegates that are here. Amen. Amen. They're in here in a great number, and it's not easy for them to come. Amen. Let's thank God for Bimini. Amen. Freeport. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Brother Blade, you'll turn me down just a little bit. Hallelujah. Amen. Texas is not here yet. Amen. Wait. Oh, Lord. You know what? I was looking for Alan. Alan is like my, that's how I know Texas is here. Because Alan be right there. We're going to miss our brother. Amen. But we know he's in glory. Amen. Hallelujah. And to the Snelling family, we're still praying for you. And we love you so much. Amen. Hallelujah. Anybody that I missed that's in the building? Canada? Oh, yes. I'm sorry. This is Carolyn. Sister Carolyn came, so Canada is here. Amen. Amen. No, Canada's in the building. Amen. We done stole one of y'all Canadians. We, you know, I ain't gonna snitch, but Prime committed the robbery. Whoa, we gotta all say congratulations to the bishop. And congratulations to Karen. Can you stand up, Karen? Saints, this is Bishop's fiance. Amen. Amen. Woo! No more all-night counseling sessions with the bishop. He gonna have to go home now. He gonna have to go home now. Amen. I just want to see. I want to see 2015 and 2016. Bishop married. Amen. Amen. And Karen sitting up there next to him. Amen. That's gonna be a beautiful sight. We're so happy for you. Amen. Karen, we're so happy for you. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Bishop. Bishop. Bishop gonna be married. Hallelujah. That's gonna take some getting used to. Amen. You can't be calling Prime to fix no.